Studio W Theater has joined with other theaters around the nation to launch the Ghostlight Project, inviting diverse opinion, open dialogue, and artistic expression. We hope to facilitate and cultivate community engagement, the courageous exchange of ideas, and a reaffirmation of all that theater means to us. Inspired by the ages-old tradition of keeping a light burning bright on the stage so that the theater is never in darkness, we, the members of the theater community, from Broadway to regional theaters, to high schools, colleges, and community theaters, have come together across the nation to join in a collective, simultaneous action, together creating light for the challenging times ahead. We wish to renew our pledge to stand for and protect the values of inclusion, participation, and compassion for everyone, regardless of race, class, religion, country of origin, immigration status, disability, gender identity, or sexual orientation.
Feminome by Patrick Alton Hurd. Violent, breaking, fleeing, gone. Yet still, our fragrant blossom blooms. Hurtful, painful, aching, all. Still, we thrive from dawn till doom. We shall not bend nor think to break. We cannot be then less than all. We are only we, no less, no heart too large, nor heart too small. Gone our silence, now hear our pain. All that's left is being, or we cannot be then less than we. We have to let our spirits be violent, breaking, fleeing, gone. Yet still our fragrant blossom blooms, hurtful, painful, aching all. Still, we thrive from dusk till doom.
Celebrate our similarities and our differences. Have you ever heard that saying, special snowflake? Often it's said in a condescending way, but I have a very different take on it. Every snowflake is a brilliant, complicated miracle expressed in complex patterns and angles, symmetry and balance, beautiful, intricate, and perfect as it is. Every snowflake is unique just as every person is unique. We were formed by all of our experiences, both good and bad. Some things we may wish have never happened, and some we wish would happen again and again and again. We may have some harsh angles made from difficult times, some patterns cut out where we had losses, but we also have the most glorious designs from our successes, our interests, the things that we have overcome, the sparkle where we have touched other people's lives in the most meaningful and brilliant ways. They have all gone into what makes us special, unique in who we are. We all have strengths as well as challenges, and I don't say weaknesses, but challenges. Things to improve, to learn, to overcome, areas to grow. Each one has made us our own being, unlike any other, like the uncountable crystalline snowflakes. We may have patterns in common with some groups, love to create, dance, sing, act, paint, tell stories, read, play music, sports or video games, whatever brings us joy. We may have calm, smooth curves in common at times, meditative, flexible, fluid, peaceful, or sharp angles, sensitive, quick to react, to anger, or to forgive, shy or expressive, humorous or intense. It's the combination of all these parts that makes us not only unique, but also makes us belong to and with each other. We may at times feel like we are floating down, drifting in the wind, but we're not alone. We have connections to many, but our pattern is made up of our own specific combination of skills and choices. If we were all the same, the world would be a terribly boring place. There are a lot of people out there who are very loud in voicing their criticisms, their condemnations of things that are different than they are. They may pretend to be confident, but most put others down because they're really not being true to themselves and are really not happy within themselves. Don't let them muddy you. Don't let them take away your sparkle. Rejoice in the amazing miracle of being you, that special snowflake, that gorgeous being that is you. When I was young, I was terribly shy. Theater was not only a love of mine, but in many ways a saving grace, a way I forced myself out of my shell to not give in to all my self-doubt and not take in all the useless criticisms of others. Art and theater give expression to all the good and bad, give us a chance to share and learn and make the world better, sometimes by commenting on the things that need to be changed. Together, our light, our sparkle, can light up the dark times, reflect light in 100 directions, and light the way for others to join us. Be kind to yourself and others. Celebrate our similarities and our differences.
Can You Guess My Name? By Josiah Houston. I wink at the man in the moon sometimes. We grew up together. He lives down the street on the highway to heaven. That old man is just like a brother to me. So sad to see him blue. The new era has begun. Can you guess my name? I'm not a preacher, but I do exchange notes with the Holy One. He does favor my ideas for the future. He did like my idea to color the sun. He has some schemes at hand, a plan for everyone, at least that's what some say. I just help him with the details, you know? The seventh day he rested, I was working a 24-hour shift to clean up that mess he made back before overtime was counted. Well, I learned my lesson. My next idea was to color in the union label. I'm not a teacher, but I answer questions, several points of view to give. I'll show you how to question everything, like the red apple or Adam. But I'm not a teacher. To teach all that I have learned on this dark rock would take 1,000 more lifetimes. Who says I have the right message to give on how to live? But I'm not a prophet. I do see the future. The days coming are not so bright, so be careful. Do what is truly right for your inner child. Hey, I am not a prophet, but I will warn you of one thing. Nobody knows when the final blow will strike, so follow your own yellow brick path. I'm not an astronomer, but I do look to the stars for guidance. Not science, just reliance. I know they will always be there, like any true friend, but I am not an astronomer. Some people follow stars. I've been known to skip a few. Consider wishing upon a star sometime. They will always be there, even the ones that fall to the sea. I'm not a believer, but I pray that I'll have a coat like Joseph someday. I don't want it like some false idol. No hopes there. I know I once was one, but I was melted down. So many cows forever lost their colors that day. But I'm not a believer. Too many false idols in this world. I'm just praying for my colorful coat. No. I'm not a mistake. I was created for a reason, with a mission and a season, a will to keep going, a fire burning within me which says no, I am not a mistake. I'm a winning lottery ticket. I'll have my chance to cash in. But everybody's got an opinion. You may even think God writes the stories around here. Who knows? You may be right, but I'm the one that tells them. I'm not white. How could I be? There seems to be too much rhythm in me. In heaven, there are no races, no division. It is something me and God are working on for the world, but it will take time. Ah, heaven. It's a nice place, they say. God might even let me in one day when my job is done. He promised he'll show me the way. See, I'm not white, although my skin may lie. How could I be? I've been resurrected so many times, I barely exist. It is hard to find my soul in the mist, but it's there, and it's not white. I'm all the colors of the world put into one. Hell, until the blood test, God thought I was his son. He named me Skittles because of my birth between the never-ending rain shower and the yellow sunshine. That was my true moment of color. Even Noah took it as a sign of peace to come. The new era has begun. I wink at the man in the moon sometimes. We grew up together. So sad to see him blue. Do not worry, my friend. The world will not come to an end. No more black and white. Skittles is coloring in the world. I intend to make things right.
What kind of lens are you seeing life through? Is it the lens of bitterness, reflecting a life of resentment and disappointments, where anger bubbles on the surface and keeps your heart hardened? Is it the lens of contentment, reflecting a life of joy and progress, accepting this beautiful gift that's life and extending your hand to journey with it? Is it the lens of fear, reflecting a life of living so far from the edge you can't even feel the breeze of possibilities? Is it the lens of courage, reflecting a life of opportunities taken and the growth experienced from jumping into faith? Is it the lens of victimization, reflecting a life of pointing the finger at everyone and everything you've convinced yourself is at fault for where you are? Is it the lens of love, reflecting a life of complete compassion? Compassion for yourself, compassion for others? I ask you again, what kind of lens are you seeing life through? If it's one that is not fueling the constructive evolution of your being, change the lens. You hold the power in the vision and how life reflects back what you allow yourself to see.
Jubilee by Mary Chapin Carpenter. I can tell by the way you're walking, you don't want company. I'll let you alone and I'll let you walk on. But in your own good time, you'll be back where the sun can find you, under the wise wishing tree, and with all of them made, we'll lie under the shade and call it a jubilee. And I can tell by the way you're talking that the past isn't letting you go. But there's only so long you can take it all on, and then the wrong's got to be on its own. And when you're ready to leave it behind you, you'll look back and all that you'll see is the wreckage and dust that you've left in the dust on your way to the Jubilee. And I can tell by the way you're listening that you're still expecting to hear your name being called, like a summons to all who have failed to account for their doubts and their fears. They can't add up to much without you. And so if it were up to me, I'd take hold of your hand, saying, come, hear the band, play your song at the Jubilee. And I can tell by the way you're searching for something you can't even name, that you haven't been able to come to the table, but we're simply glad that you came. When you feel like this, try to imagine that we're all like frail boats on the sea, just scanning the night for that great guiding light, announcing the Jubilee. And I can tell by the way you're standing, with your eyes filling with tears, that it's habit alone that keeps you turning for home, even though your home is right here, where the people who love you are gathered. Under the wise wishing tree, may we all be considered and then straight on delivered down to the Jubilee. Because the people who love you are waiting and will wait just as long as need be, and then we'll look back and say, those are halcyon days. We're talking about Jubilee.
Thank you. Discrimination by Taryn Chester. A word grown from the seed of hatred, watered with ignorance and loathing, rising in gnarled, twisted vines that sprout up into a blackened sky. As its roots sink like claws into naive victims, whose ignorance does not bring them bliss, but revulsion at anything that stands out from their rotten rose garden. They stand upon false pedestals, preaching pitiful poems of prejudice, spewing subliminal stories of sinister plots behind a beautiful veil of deadly deceptions. They kill with their words, tearing families apart with carbon-copied molds children can no longer fit in. Names, terms, designations, those that determine whether you can sit in the front with the squeaky clean or are pushed to the torn, holy seats in the back. Whether you stand up and walk out or allow yourself to be consumed by the deception and drown in the tears of, if only I had spoken up. If only you had spoken up. Maybe that girl your friend called a whale would be alive. She sank in her sadness because she was not a whale. She was a person. And now she's gone. If only you had spoken up. Maybe the boy whose skin resembled coffee instead of the creamer they shoved down our throats wouldn't leave school with a taste of sour milk in his mouth, as clouds of offensive smog block his vision of those who really love him. If only you had spoken up. Maybe the little boy who wants to wear a tutu wouldn't fear the forces of foreign phrases like fag, trapping him in a dark cage of stereotypes and loneliness. If only you had spoken up. Maybe the girl wrapped up in tight cloth would be seen as human instead of a threat to national security. If only you had spoken up. If only. You have the power to change. So stand up. Speak out. And change.
Well over 600 theaters, ensembles, high schools and universities from all 50 states are right now, at this moment, simultaneously gathered together, just as we are here at Studio W Theater in Wallingford, Connecticut. They are honoring the hundreds of years old tradition of the ghost light, a single light kept on the stage so that the theater is never in darkness. Expanding on that idea, thousands of people across the country have chosen this time to reaffirm a pledge to protect the values of inclusion, participation, and compassion for everyone, regardless of race, class, religion, country of origin, immigration status, disability, gender identity, or sexual orientation. It is our hope that we can shine a light on the status of theaters and schools as places where it is safe to be who you are, where diverse opinions, dissent, and argument are not only tolerated, but invited, where active listening and courageous exchange are fundamental values, and activism and community engagement, both within and outside the walls of the theater, are cultivated, encouraged, and supported. In the words of Sahim Ali, director and member of the Ghostlight Project Steering Committee, the act of expressing something out loud has significance. It demonstrates solidarity and a firmness of belief. Our most solemn ceremonies, weddings, graduations, ordinations are by design public and communal because they demand witnesses. We here at Studio W Theater and WPAA-TV want to thank you for tuning in and bearing witness to the first ever live nationwide Ghostlight Project broadcast. Now, I'd like to perform a piece I wrote in response to those whom I was unable to bring here. I call it Activist by Noel Ramos. I'm not an activist. I'm not into politics. I struggled for a response, but I came up empty. Why? Truth is, I'm no activist either, and I always hated politics. I am a person. I have bills to pay, a woman to love, a job to do. I have a life to live. I have no time for politics. All those suits with their red and blue ties, telling lies. And I'm certainly no activist. Oh, I complain about the scams and the ripoffs. I shake my fist at the corruption and waste I see every day. But in my heart, I feel like a tiny voice in a universe of scraping, grinding, grating noise. I'll never be heard. So how can I convince them to come here and bare their souls in a darkened theater? Why should they step into the ghost light? Perhaps it's not about activism or politics at all. Maybe being simply a person is what it's all about. A human being with intrinsic rights to exist, to be, and to express that existence in whatever way their being requires. Maybe it's as simple as stating what should be obvious. We live on a fragile, tiny blue ball, hurling through cosmic chaos. We need each other. We define each other and our humanity. What do we want that definition to be? You don't have to be an activist, and you don't need to be into politics. You just need to be human. That's why you should step into the ghost light. Reaffirm your humanity. Prove that some things transcend politics. Show us that what we've built together over the millennia has worth and pays tribute to the lives that were given to create it. Show us that civilization matters. Tell us, as you glow in the light, about freedom of expression, freedom to be who we are, freedom from oppression, freedom to dissent, to invent, to experiment, be free from judgment, from harassment, entitlement, torment, freedom to vent. Tell us that being a person means something. Tell us about you in the ghost light.
Dark and light, light and dark. Jackie James. Blackmail, blacklist, black mark, black Monday, black mood, black hearted, black plague, black mass, black market. Good guys wear white, bad guys wear black. We fear black cats and the dark continent, but it's okay to tell a white lie. Lily white hands are coveted. It's great to be pure as the driven snow. Angels and brides wear white. Devil's food cake is chocolate. Angel's food cake is white. We shape language, and we are shaped by it. In our culture, white is esteemed. It is heavenly, sun-like, clean, pure, immaculate, innocent, and beautiful. At the same time, black is evil, wicked, gloomy, depressing, angry, sullen. Ascribing negative and positive values to black and white enhances the institutionalization of this culture's racism. Let us acknowledge the negative connotations of whiteness. White things can be soft, vulnerable, pallid, and ashen. Light can be blinding, bleaching, enervating. Conversely, we must acknowledge that darkness has a redemptive character, that in darkness there is power and beauty. The dark nurtured and protected us before our birth. Welcome darkness. Don't be afraid of it or deny it. Darkness brings relief from the blinding sun, from scorching heat, from exhausting labor. Night signals permission to rest, to be with our loved ones, to conceive new life, to search our hearts, to remember our dreams.
The dark of winter is a time of hibernation. Seeds grow in the dark, fertile earth. The words black and dark don't need to be destroyed or ignored, only balanced and reclaimed in their wholeness. The words white and light don't need to be destroyed or ignored, only balanced and reclaimed in their wholeness. Imagine a world that had only light or dark. We need both, dark and light, light and dark.
Good and Black by Adele Houston. Four generations stretching a good table, fine china well smeared with gravy, and the blood of cranberries as the dapper four-year-old topples dessert in conversation. That's bullshit! What follows? The murmur of mimic, watershed tales of preschool teacher complaints, a rambled what can be done retort to what was heard, spoken, repeated. That's bullshit! Small talk brews aromatic. What can be done? Topics twist to most seen TV, turns to telling stories of road rage. Son and daughters tasting how possible a chiffon identification with fear, the shooter's fear, emerges like apples from the cut wedge of the other pie. It must have been one, no, Grandma. Both were women. Both were white. Pours past Diet Coke, Asti, rooibos, running at the mouth. Well, most times it's men. Most times it is blacks, shooting even each other. No, Grandma. Steams above black coffee. Every time it is a person with a gun, made only to shoot people. A handgun in an angry hand. More pie with your drink of choice? Every holiday there is too much. Anyone else need tea? Consumptive shallows drip into internet shopping. What children get? Everything they do not need. Did you hear? Current events get swallowed like the offer of a second dessert. Discomfort to return later. She is 75. She repeats what she believes above sugar-powdered angel's wings. She fears the real thing. The child hears fear and repeats. The child gets everything. That's bullshit. Is mimic in the world. Good and black for Christmas.
If my inner thoughts could speak about you, here's what I'd say. You are wrong about me. You've strengthened me. You fuel my passions, my fire, my energy. I appreciate you. Because it's the growing group of you that makes me rise up when I'm weak. On days I feel like giving up, I think of you, and it motivates me to rock my shit hard. The downers, the haters, the bitches, the fakers, all of you combined I face single-handedly as I climb to a goal in my mind that only I foresee, that only I can touch, that only I can reach. The sweetest payback is in the paycheck, but something greater than myself. Reaching higher while the echoes in my mind grow fainter. In time, you become my past. In time, I become your future.
President Roosevelt was quoted as saying, "The president is merely the most important among a large number of public servants. He should be supported or opposed exactly to the degree which is warranted by his good conduct or bad conduct, his efficiency or inefficiency in rendering loyal, able, and disinterested service to the nation as a whole. Therefore, it is absolutely necessary that there should be full liberty to tell the truth about his acts, and this means that it is exactly as necessary to blame him when he does wrong as to praise him when he does right. Any other attitude in an American citizen is both base and servile. To announce that there must be no criticism of the president, or that we are to stand by the president, right or wrong, is not only unpatriotic and servile, but is morally treasonable to the American public. Nothing but the truth should be spoken about him or anyone else. But it is even more important to tell the truth, pleasant or unpleasant, about him than about anyone else.
Mithridatism. Lee, a self-made business person, has made concessions in her life that leave her questioning her identity. In this pivotal scene, Lee finally confronts the man she loves with his racist worldview. I know you think of me as white, but I am not white. And honey, you can keep on trying to convince yourself you're not different, and love changes everything, but we leave this room still be white, and I still be other. That's the bottom line. And it's not just the world outside this room that's prejudiced. It's you, Frank. Because as long as you only see me and accept me in your white perspective, you'll never truly see me. So don't tell me you're not prejudiced until you're willing to put yourself in my shoes and see the world from my point of view. Don't tell me you're not prejudiced until you come out from around the illusion that we're all the same, because we are not the same. This is a white man's world, Frank, and I'm not white. And you seeing me as such that negates my entire existence. If you see me as white, I'm not here. I'm nothing to you, because I'm not white, Frank. I'm other, and I know you give money to charities to help the other, and you love the other, but you only do it so the other, including me, will rise above their circumstances to be more like you. White, like you. And that, Frank, is the worst kind of racist. The one who doesn't even know who he is.
There are questions you need to ask, because a question needs to be asked, even though you know the answer is no. You ask because it will change the people asked, and you. There are questions you need to ask because it's part of the process, even though you're sure the answer is yes. And when the answer is no, you're devastated, confused, and it changes you more than you can imagine, and you hope the people you asked. There are questions you need to ask, even though there's no answer, that you can see, and still your soul cries out, why, as you wait for the promise to change.
Hey there, my name's Phil, and I'm a right-wing Republican, and I've been a right-wing Republican going back to my teenage years. Do I shock you? Do I disgust you? Do you think I'm at the root of what's wrong with this country today? Or are you even vaguely curious to know why my political arrow points in that direction? Sometimes I find it impossible to have a political conversation with people that have different opinions. More times than I care to recall, I'll offer my point of view on a specific issue and people will start calling me names. Now, I'm not having a political conversation with little kids in the schoolyard. These are self-identified intelligent adults who try to shut me up and shut me down by calling me names. To date, I've been called un-American by two different people. I've been called stupid, racist, clueless, and a Nazi. And the risk of being catty, I was called those names by people who claim to be tolerant. But is it tolerant to belittle and demean people who have different opinions on political issues? I was always under the impression that tolerance is a two-way street. You get to share ideas with others, listen to what they have to say, and ask questions or make observations regarding the merits and fuzzy edges of the other person's presentation. Now, of course, I have to admit that we on the right have more than a few characters that have taken name-calling to abusive extremes. Yet at the same time, I'm aware that about a half century ago, the great conservative commentator William F. Buckley Jr. set aside the first episode of his talk show Firing Line by welcoming the influential socialist leader Norman Thomas as his very first guest. There was no name-calling on that program. No one was stupid or clueless or a Nazi. It was an intelligent and invigorating exchange of ideas. Now, our current political climate has become toxic, but I don't think it's been completely destroyed beyond hope. I encourage people from all corners of the political spectrum to speak to each other, but more importantly, I encourage people to listen to what the other side has to say and respond in a respectful manner. You don't have to agree with everyone, but at the same time, you don't have to be rude to them.
Do you want to dance? It started way before the music, choosing what to wear, being comfortable, but having that swish and swing. Tired, but knowing once it begins that every other stress will fade away as though they don't exist, at least for a little while. I walk in wondering if I'll know anyone, half the time fighting the urge to run back to the quiet and safety of my bed, but I force each step. The room is empty of people, arriving early to help set up, moving the chairs and tables, opening up the floor. The sounds of the band warming up and tuning their instruments add to the excitement. People begin to arrive and the music starts in earnest. Do you want to dance? Do you want to lead or follow? Yes, 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 of course I want to dance, more than anything. I prefer to follow, but I can lead. In fact, it's more fun to take turns. A few steps to get in sync, and then joyful swivels, swing outs, round and round the floor. Do you know this move? Yes. Do you know this one? No. Please show me. On to the next song and the next partner. Some partners strong and a few a little too pushy. Others weak and need of a bit more practice. Others so light, but so clear and perfect communication through their fingertips. One of my favorites, counterbalancing, like we're doing a martial arts dance. The movements feel so natural and so intense. No room for thinking, the body just moves. Bodies move together fast, slow, turning, swing outs, hips swiveling, moving together, step, double step, back step, hearts beating, breathing coming faster. The most delicious exhaustion ending in smiles and laughter. Thank you, thank you. I go to dance, not date. I go because I'm in love with the dance and sharing it with others. Each dance is like a love affair, from the greeting, crescendos and denouement, ending with gratefulness. I dance across the state. I'll drive hours. Hartford Underground, Providence Swing, Yale Swing and Blues. My favorite, I think, is Yale. The rules are joyful. If you're asked to dance, you say yes, unless you're too tired or in pain, and then you just say later. After, do you want to dance, is, do you want to lead or follow? No judgment, girl or guy. Not just men lead and women follow, but women might dance with women and men with men. Women may lead or follow or change partway through the dance. Everyone is equal. Everyone is connected. Some amazing, some struggling or learning, some strong and some soft, some fast and some slow. Each with our own style, each becoming more precious and vibrant with the contrast of the previous and the next. Hand holding hand, white, black, tan, pale, rough or smooth, working or manicured, male or female, big or small, regardless of religion, race, sex, sexual preference or identity, all joined in the same joyful expression of love and acceptance and dance together as it should be.
Facebook politics, bobolinks, and grace. I pause from my studies of the dark night of the soul and find a friend has posted, "Sorry, I'm not on Facebook much right now. I need to do things that don't fill me with anger and despair." So I shared with her a picture of a bobolink and a poem of how the prairie smells after a summer rain and thought about this week's lesson. One's life does not consist in the abundance of possessions. Despite what the commercials say, the politician's promise leads to anger, wrath, malice, and slander, and abusive language. For them, there are still slave and free, those who help them gain riches, and others who obstruct them. My friend writes, "Sorry, I'm not on Facebook much right now. I need to do things. They don't fill me with anger and despair." "But you are needed," I tell her. "To remind all of us, the moon cannot be stolen."
He-Man, A Man from Vermont, by Adele Houston. What makes America work? Grandpa slipped his soul into conversation like a late night visit to the cookie jar. Clandestine spirit, satisfaction, sweet energy. His eyes twinkled with exclamation. "It's people. I suspect this old Democrat who fed her party fundraising letters in the lavish list of a nesting oriole took a vital life step. The day this question, what makes America work, infested his psyche. He left pastoral rural Vermont, the farm earnest sweet for the sweet flavors of a dream. His hands and back, suppled and furrowed as the land. His mind, quick to cast off, long like shadows on robed corn. His morning, up with the chickens. His retirement, retooling the incorruptible gears of his clock set for a century. Meticulous ideas sprung from a barn, welded by the heat of a coal stove. The syrup runs, and the sugar house glows. The morning rises after the mountain. He is a Vermonter. Our visits began with the drive north, off the concrete highway by dark, along riverbeds of boulders, hints of streams, long steep trails, shadows of logged timber littered with birches, white and yellowed, a patchwork hill night capped with balsam firs. Collectively, we retired our eyes, slumped head to shoulder, quilted grandchildren in the back of a seat of a 64 Impala. There was an aimless, busy quality about the cutting of rhubarb and asparagus, the harvesting of berries by the peck, tractor rides that turned up potatoes, brook crossing, stepping stones to reach snow pea vines. In the yard, there were four John Deere seats recycled on a round-around and a moonwalk grain mover among the chickens. There were reincarnation promises. The 52 Pontiac car hood would clear the ice pond in winter. There was game to be eaten, not played with. There were mysteries and hymns, cistern water, and the fraternal order of Masons. More than half a century later, the maple stirrup still sweetened whatever went with eggs, still fresh from hens in the yard. The tractor pulling what the man could once manage by hand, the barn still full of mystery, and the conversation often leaving Vermont and returning, just like the man. Fresh eggs. A sign brings back all that his grandpa, all that he man dreamed, the Green Mountains.
An Yoshimoto by Janet Allard, a Japanese woman in her 30s, December 8th, 1942, Honolulu. Sam Yoshimoto, 5'6", 35 years of age, last seen wearing a brown dock worker's uniform, last seen Pearl Harbor, 8 a.m. yesterday. This is my husband. Have you seen him? Are you okay? You look a little shaken up. Me too. Are you okay? My husband, he says, I'm going to work. I haven't seen his face in 2 days. But my husband, he says, I am so glad we came to Hawaii. So beautiful here. You're so lucky you were born here. He is from Japan. I teach him to talk better English from Mother Goose. He learned with our kids. Chicken licking, the sky is falling, fee-fi-fo-fum, the sky is falling. Yesterday, he wake up early. He says, I'm going to work. Why do you go so early? Come back to bed, I say. Come stay, warm in here. It's chilly out there. I'm up, he says. What you gonna do so early? I'm gonna shoot the shit, he say. He picked up all the boys' talk, like a toilet at the docks. Pearl Harbor. Have you seen him? Look close. I hear nothing. 2 days now. Mochiko, her husband called, right after. He's busy, we're cutting into the Oklahoma. The damn thing is sunk with 32 men still inside. They're trying to use the torch, but the damn thing would blow up, so they're cutting through the metal by hand. The water is on fire, he says. 32 men still inside. Do you ever feel useless? I am a teacher. Today I wish I was a nurse. I can see the harbor from my window. All the lights off, they say. So I keep my lights off. Sherry's son, he called. He say, I see the planes coming with the red meatball on the wings. He say, I see the guy's face, the pilot, so close I could hit him with a rock, if I had a rock. So close, I could see his expressions. He was smiling. When I look in the mirror this morning, I notice I'm Japanese. What am I supposed to do? I'm Japanese. On the radio, they say, Japan is the enemy. Is that what you see when you look at me? Is my face different today than it was yesterday? What do you think? Are you different today? Where is Sam? Is he here? Someone said they took him for questioning. Took him where? I come down here to ask you. Maybe you would know. Here, I brought you some mochi. Would you like to try? You know, mochi, rice flour. Sweet, pink, white, blue, green. It's Sam's favorite. Is he here? My name, you can write this down, is An Yoshimoto. My husband is Sam Mosh Yoshimoto. He is 5'6", black hair, brown eyes. He is Japanese. Is there anything you can tell me? Ask me. I am here to cooperate. We are all in this thing together. All the other wives, they sit and wait. I cannot sit. I cannot wait. They say I am in danger to come see you, to take the bus, because the outside rumors are flying like fire and people are trigger happy today if you are Japanese. I need to do something, anything. From your window, you can see the sky is smoke. Does the smell stay in your nose all day, all night? Do you wake up and smell burning, burning oil, burning skin? Where is Sam? Do you have any questions for me? Would you like to know what I think of Japan when I was last there? Who I know? Who comes to visit? Can I sing the Star Spangled Banner? Do I love my country? Yes. And your eyes say, which one? How do you tell a little girl her father can't come home tonight? Why? Because he's being held for questions. Why? Because he is Japanese. Why? Because he works at Pearl Harbor maintenance. Why? Because Pearl Harbor is on fire. Why? Because Japan hates America? Why? 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 But I Japanese? Yes. But am I American? Yes. My son, he say, Mommy, am I a Jap? Japanese. He say, am I Japanese? I say, yes. He say, nothing. I say, are you afraid? He say, what's going to happen? Now I am asking you, what's going to happen? Why are you sitting there silent? Are you holding here for questioning? What kind of questions? How can a man kill with a smile on his face? How can you sit there in that chair and stare at me and fold your hands in your lap when there are 2,000 men burning, falling, screaming, and an ocean on fire, 2 miles from here? How can you sit in that chair? Is there anything useful you can do? Can you drive me down there? Are you afraid of smoke or fire, of bombs, of dying, of war, of Japanese, of others? Are we afraid of each other? We should be down there. We should be with the fire and the smoke. We should be cutting the men out of the ship with our hands. We should be all down there helping, all of us. I'm not useless. Are you? I'm not afraid. I'm not made of stone. Are you? Are those your car keys in your hand? Can you take me down there?
Because every day, on average, 22 veterans of the United States military take their own lives in the form of suicide. And in an effort to help bring awareness to this problem, I present to you this short monologue. It's impossible for words to describe what is necessary to those that do not know what horror means. Horror. Horror has a face. And when you are at war, you must make friends with horror. Horror and moral terror must be your friends. Otherwise, they will become your enemies. And they are truly enemies to be feared. So, what is necessary? What is necessary is that we be able to be both moral and strong, while at the same time have that ability to summon that primordial ability to kill. To kill without feeling, without passion, without judgment. Without judgment. It's judgment that defeats us.
Sonnet 94 by William Shakespeare. They that have power to hurt and will do none, that do not do the thing they most do show, who, moving others, are themselves as stone, unmoved, cold, and to temptation slow, they rightly do inherit heaven's graces, and husband nature's riches from expense. They are the lords and owners of their faces, others but stewards of their excellence. The summer's flower is to the summer sweet, though to itself it only live and die. But if that flower with base infection meet, the basest weed outbraves his dignity. For sweetest things turn sourest by their deeds. Lilies that fester smell far worse than weeds.
Watch night, white privilege. As a white man from the North, brought up in the 20th century, I can only imagine life on a plantation with slaves. It goes something like this. Sometimes, when I couldn't sleep, I would sneak out of the plantation house and down to the slave quarters where I would hear them talk about great adventures, seeking some wonderful prize, traveling through dangerous swamps like wise men following a star. Not the Star of Bethlehem, but the Northern Star. They would stop when they saw me and Auntie. She wasn't really my aunt, it's just she took care of us like a good aunt should, unlike my mom's older sister, a widow, who lived with us, and she was very strict and stern and worried about uprisings and wanted us to keep the slaves in their places. Auntie would talk kindly to me and take me back to the plantation house. I think mostly the slaves liked me, although I never really knew if it was just Christian charity or deference to their master's son, but I'd get frustrated when they talked about their concerns and told me I couldn't understand or help. When I started noticing how pretty some of the slave girls my age were and flirting with them, I hoped they would like me and not just smile because of my power and prestige. Then some of the slave boys started getting meaner to me. Then the war came. They wanted their freedom. I just wanted our old way of life back. Sure, my dad owned slaves, but I never did. A century and a half later, I read about another black kid killed in the riots and Black Lives Matter. The black folks I know tell me I wouldn't understand because of my white privilege, whatever that is. The buildings of the great institutions where I studied and worshiped were built by slaves, but I wasn't involved. I don't have to have the talk before my kids walk down the street and the police and doctors and teachers and others all treat me justly. I just want things to go back to how they used to be, before all this racial tension.
Once again, ladies and gentlemen, thank you so much for joining us for the first ever live broadcast of the Ghostlight Project here on WPAA-TV at Studio W Theater. So glad you could join us, and I want to thank all my activists for being here and sharing a little bit of themselves with us, and a lot of other people too. We're going to close out the show with one more activist, and after that, we'll be on Facebook.
America was driving down the highway, texting with friends about how bad the other drivers were, while distracted by a radio show about someone else's email server, and not noticing its impact on less fortunate people or the environment when it rear-ended stalled international collaboration. Pins and pens. I'll be back in a couple of hours, I said, as casually as I could, as I set out for the foreclosure auction of the old family home. I wasn't talking about the schedule for the day. I was making a promise to my loved ones, to myself, that it would be okay after this trying time. Years later, when xenophobia started winning more elections, I put on a safety pin to let others know I care. I will do what I can to help and to remind me of the Pledge of Allegiance, with liberty and justice for all, for everyone, created in the Imago Dei, for my neighbors God commanded me to love. Now all I have is my pen and paper and a safety pin, which is much more than MacGyver ever had. And I ask you to join me in donning the pin and wielding the pen and helping make sure that love really does win.
You can visit theghostlightproject.com for more information, find out more about the movement, its nationwide status, where it's going from here, what's going to happen next year. I also want to send big thanks out to WPAA-TV for allowing us to broadcast live, and most importantly to you for tuning in. And also want to send out big thank you to all of those who tried to give us their Facebook Live feeds.